Good evening. Welcome to the Deerfield Sewer Study Committee meeting on November 15th at 6 p.m. at the town offices here in South Deerfield. Some of the things we're going to do this evening is review and approve the minutes of 10/13/16. Discuss all of the five-year capital improvement plan and other capital expenses. See what other businesses we have and set a date and adjourn until our next meeting. So, has everybody had a chance to read the minutes, or would you like a couple of minutes to do so?
Meeting of October 13th?
Yes.
We had a note on the minutes saying a Mass Works project we should hear by the end of the month. And that was by October, and this is November. Did we get any word on that?
Yes, we did. It's negative.
Okay. And did they give us any other guidance that we can do to try and help that along or not?
Not that I'm aware of. Kevin, is there anything that you've heard from them?
Basically, at this point in time right now, my general understanding is we're just going to have to resubmit for next year. But there's a bunch of things that Tony would like to discuss tonight. If we do have the following year to be able to go ahead and prepare for it, we feel that we should actually have a plan so we actually know what we want to do besides just the headworks. What are you going to do with South Deerfield? What are you going to do with Old Deerfield? Are you going to make it a forest main? Are you going to turn it around? Are you going to shut it down? You know, what is the plan overall? You know, are we planning on looking at increasing our sewage area? These are all things. This is the planning stage.
Yep.
And we have time now. So realistically, what we could do is you could be looking at it and saying, okay, well, no, hypothetically, maybe we're going to go ahead and we're going to increase the amount of areas that we're going to do. So that right there may give you a little bit more of a bump into a higher class or higher prestige, per se, yeah, as far as being able to get your application approved. But I do believe Tony will be talking about that this evening.
Well, let's kind of jump back to the minutes. Does anybody have a chance to read them? Or?
On page 5, they said about a half dozen sentences down, it says, BS, why are we promoting conservation at sending rates would do this? Don't have an issue with lack of flow. That says conservation is our, and there's nothing there. So I'm not sure what they're trying to say there.
I think what I was at is working against us is what is conservation works against us on that. Is what they.
So you're going to make that correction and.
I. Go ahead. You're done with that one.
Hmm. That's.
It just says conservation is our, yeah, and then there's nothing.
And that was by my line, and I, you know, that's one of the things I've said right along is conservation works against us. Because there is barely enough flow to. Mm-hmm.
So you want to change it to conservation works against us?
No.
Yeah. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I would.
And piece of the performance.
When Bruce sent them out by email, I read them and had 4 comments that I sent. I asked him if he wanted me to let him know then or now, tonight. He said then. I said he was going to correct him. So do you want to hear about them now?
Sure. Did you do the minutes, Bruce? Or did
no, Bruce Hunter.
Bruce Hunter.
Do you want to postpone them until Bruce is here?
Yeah, we're better off doing that. Yeah.
Doing what?
All right. Wait until Bruce Hunter is here.
I think so. We may.
All right.
Just put them on hold.
All right. Well, that's what we'll do. We'll put it on hold until our next meeting and review them at that time. I guess the discussion on our five-year capital improvement plan or other capital expenses is going to continue to be the topic. And do you have a presentation for us tonight?
I was asked by Keith. You guys, Keith reached out to me and said you guys had a bunch of questions on just the wastewater system in general. So I asked Keith to put together the questions that you had.
Yep.
I emailed them to me. I prepared a memorandum outlining each of them, and I don't know if you guys want to go through that. You want to talk about your capital plan?
Yeah, I'm not sure who did, Bruce Hunter originate these questions?
No, it came from all the whole committee.
Committee.
John, Juan Oreski, Bruce Hunter, and Jeff Upton, I believe.
And I think they're all funneled through Keith.
He invited everybody in there.
And then Keith gave them to the engineer.
Yep.
Okay.
It is. And then I handed it back off to Bruce, and, but many of you expressed a desire for clarification and answers to a lot of questions, so I prepared those in advance. I asked you guys, submit them in advance. I submitted them to Tony. He's answered, but he's here to answer them too. Clarify any other further questions or discuss prices, costs, plans, anything like that.
Is there any particular order or anything that anyone wants to start with, or you just want to go through this list? Or?
Well, we probably have to go through the list, but I think as a committee, we should decide whether we shut down Old Deerfield or not. That should be a first task, that's my opinion, because so much rides on whether we keep it or decommission. I don't know if that falls into tonight. But
I believe that's,
I think that's,
that's the beginning of your questions. Here, the answers.
But I do have a, I have a question. The Old Deerfield plant now, its customers, so to speak, really largely are three institutions, three education institutions.
Correct.
So is there any like precedent for private or institutional users taking over a town-owned, if they're the only users, is there any precedent for that, and how can that legally happen?
I can probably answer for Tony on this one. We've already approached Deerfield Academy, and Deerfield Academy says no.
Who did you approach?
Keith Finan.
And
Keith Finan, your chief financial officer.
And why did he say no?
It's not beneficial to him whatsoever.
The primary reason is it's a town responsibility, whether anybody likes to admit it or not. And they're not in the business of running sewers. They're in the business of educating kids. So they simply, it's like paying taxes. They can volunteer to pay whatever they want, but you can't make them do anything.
Well, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that, would it make any sense to invite the three representatives of the three schools here to explore this together, since they're really the, you know,
the primary users. You're right.
They're the primary users. That, you know, the town's going to spend $10 million either to upgrade the plant or to build a sewer line to South Deerfield, either way. So, and they're going to have to be largely pay for it in user fees, right? So,
just to put something into perspective, Northfield Mount Hermon School is right up the road in Gill. They have their, there's no sewer in Gill, but they have their own sewage treatment plant that the school owns, and the school operates, and the school maintains. I don't know what happened in the 70s when these facilities were built, but just my understanding of the programs, because all the schools were there, the town most likely tried and successfully got some clean water funding, which at the time was 80% grant, 20% loan, to build those facilities. Because obviously you have a population density and you have a potential for pollution there from failing septic systems. So I see your point of trying to turn the treatment plant over to the schools, but I think it has to be kind of a two-way street. I don't think can force it down their throat.
You know, I'm not talking about before, I'm not saying that at all. But to me, an advantage would be they have no monthly bill, so to speak, if they were operating them, and they would have control over the, with a phone call, they could raise, your Bill Academy could raise $10 million to build a new plant. And then they would have no user fees for the next, they have the cost of operating the plant, but they, so that might be an advantage. They seem to be buying property in Old Deerfield. every property that comes on the market, they seem to buy. And I don't know the reason for that, but perhaps there's an investment side to that, maybe? I don't know. I don't know. But it's getting to the point where, well, there were 31 private, our last meeting, there were 31 private sewage users, and now there's 30. Because Deerfield bought another house on Main Street.
But they'll still technically be a user, but I understand what you're saying.
You know what I'm saying?
There are still a few residents out there. I don't know how you would deal with that, but...
I don't know. It just seems like it, we're, you know, to spend... I'm not in favor of the town upgrading the plant and spending $10 million to upgrade the plant. The $10 million to run a sewer line from Old Deerfield to South Deerfield seems like a tremendous burden also for our, you know, for our little town. And you know, maybe there'd be some development that would follow from that, but I don't know. I just don't see that the demographics are in our favor.
We can spend $10 million one way or the other.
Spend $10 million one way or the other.
Can I just half a sec? And I'm not trying to cut that theory off. Just so, because I'm sure there's a lot of people on TV land that doesn't recognize, just Tony DeSimone, he's with Weston Sampson. And for any of you that don't know who he is, give me a little latitude for background here on him. Basically, a lot of the things that Tony's done with us the past 2.5, almost 3 years, has been pretty much pro bono, minus the headworks program. So I just wanted everyone to understand that Weston and Sampson is not here just to dig for jobs to make money. He's done a lot of legwork well ahead of time. He's helped us out. He's helped me out on a couple different projects at no cost. So I just want everyone just to be aware of that ahead of time. And again, the next way, so everybody knows who Tony is.
I have a question. Have any of these sewage treatment plants been privatized, where people come in and bid it out and then they operate it like a private business, where we would give over all the town's right, title, and interest to all of it and let them figure out how to make it work?
When you do privatization, it's on the operations end. It's not on the owning of the infrastructure end. And typically what the private operators like to do is, after you've upgraded the plant, they come in, then they operate it, and for lack of a better term, they typically run it into the ground, run through all the spare parts, run the equipment to the end of the useful life, and then hand you back a plant that then needs several million dollars more worth of equipment.
No, but that's not what I was talking about. I'm talking about where they'd actually come in and purchase it, and they would own it, and whatever fees and what have you they would set up would have to be regulated by Department of Public Utilities or whoever would have had the ability to regulate it.
I haven't seen it done on the wastewater side. I have seen it done on the water side.
So it was done successfully on the water side?
There are large water companies. I believe Massachusetts, on the eastern part of the state, has Aquarian Water that owns the water systems in several towns. And even your water system right here in Deerfield is technically a private, because the town doesn't...
Yeah, technically, because it's a district.
The only thing you may run into on the wastewater side is the federal government put a lot of money in the 70s, and there becomes issues that way.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, is something that we could explore as a way of trying to solve this problem going forward. And, you know, I follow what John is mentioning over there, that, you know, it's a lot of money. And to spend $10 million to service 34 customers or 35 customers is not very cost-effective right now.
Well, that's a good idea, I think. And a private enterprise might like a situation where they have three fantastic customers. Three customers are going to pay their bill every month. And they're relatively large customers. So.
But, Tony's saying we're still stuck with a plant, though, typically.
No. He's saying that if you hire somebody to come in and bid the management out, they run it to the ground and leave you with a broken-down plant.
Right.
What I'm saying is we're taking a divorce. We're leaving it, and we're looking for somebody that wants to buy it and agree to preserve the service in that village. And there's so many customers, and whoever owns it is going to have the ability to set the fees so that they don't go under. I'm not saying it should happen or what happened. I'm just saying we owe it to look at all the options out there. And maybe somebody would want to do it.
Keith?
I think Tony at one point came up with a figure on how many new customers would be able to tie in if we do a force main. Do you remember what that was, Tony?
So I don't have the exact number of connections that you could have, but just to give you guys some round numbers. So the two options you have, the three options you would have for Old Deerfield would be, one, you'd upgrade the plant. Two, you'd build a pump station and a force main that would either go to the South Deerfield treatment plant, or you could go to the Greenfield treatment plant. If you were to pump it to South Deerfield, you'd have roughly 18,000 linear feet of force main that then would connect into a gravity sewer over by the current Butterfly Conservatory. And then from there, you'd be able to sewer that entire stretch of Route 5 to where it ties into your current collection system. The other option, going to Greenfield, you're looking at roughly 14,000 linear feet of pipe. But you do have a bridge crossing to get over the river before you get into Greenfield. Rough numbers, take the gravity extension out. The cost of the force main to get to the gravity extension in South Deerfield and the cost of the force main to get to Greenfield at a planning level are basically the same capital costs.
And was septic not an option for Old Deerfield because it's in a floodplain? And
no, Massachusetts general laws requires a treatment plant for any flow over 10,000 gallons per day.
Oh, that's right.
So you have to have a treatment plant there. Your current flows, even with some of the II work you've done, Keith, correct me if I'm wrong, is roughly 80,000 gallons a day.
That's correct. Yep.
So are you saying that there wouldn't be the possibility of new hookups north of the Butterfly Museum?
No, you could still hook up. The sewer's there, but I wouldn't recommend putting gravity there. You're going through farm fields. And when I presented costs, again, I haven't done any engineering analysis, and I assumed worst case you'd be in the road. So you've got paving is a substantial cost because it's a state road. Realistically, I'd be telling you to get the pipe off the road. You're going through basically the shoulder where there's a bunch of farm fields. The digging should be pretty easy, and you don't have to pay for pavement restoration. So those costs that I've shown you guys are, well, I would say, conservative, because at this level, until you've done additional investigations and more work, I'd rather tell you a project's going to be $10 million and have it come in at 7 than tell you it's going to be 7 and have it come in at 10.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong, Tony, but a lot of these numbers you're coming up with is obviously because we have not gone into an actual engineering end of it, and this is perspective from what you have had, what you've seen in the past.
Yes.
So these numbers right here, and again, correct me if I'm wrong, are not steadfast, hard numbers. These are, for a poor choice of words, an educated guesstimate is what it is. He's taking information from what he's seen in the past. I mean, there could be some things that could come to our advantage. We could save a boatload of money. And there's some other things that may come into play that is unforeseen until the engineering's done, and that may cost more money.
So if I understand, it's going to cost us money if we get down 5 and 10 because of the blacktop and what have you. But if we get down Mill Village Road, we got one hill to go up after it goes down. Would that be a better alternative to go Mill Village Road? You're not going to get any connections off of it other than a few condos because most of the ag rights have been sold all the way down through.
Well, here's the other thing is I think there's, and I think it's one of, it's actually if you go towards, and I really hate to bounce around too much. I want to say it's near the end of your packet. Where's your?
With the maps.
With the maps?
Yeah.
Yeah, I had some questions about those.
I do believe there was areas in there that could be sewered. You know, you're looking at Lee Road. You could probably go ahead and pick up Sangley North. Sangley South, there's nothing there to pick up. Boynton Road, that general plain road.
But you got a bridge crossing to do.
You got a bridge crossing. I mean, you know, it obviously it's not going to be an easy task no matter what we do. But what I'm looking at is the possibility of, if you're trying to go ahead and get these different things in there, adding these other people, will it help offset the overall operating costs in the long run?
Is that the main purpose of this as far as the sewer line extensions? Just simply to add people to lower the cost, spread the cost around more?
So the only way to change the sewer rates, or there's two ways. You either change your operating budget or you change the denominator. Operating budgets aren't going down. They're only going to be going up as we start to see more and more inflation. But the way you change the sewer rate is you change the denominator. And we've, in other communities where they've done substantial sewer increases, and I'm just going to throw round numbers out and use round numbers. Say your sewer rates are $700 a household, and you extend sewers and you add another 400 households, and you charge a $15,000 betterment, which is a standard betterment that's charged here in the Commonwealth, and it costs you in debt service $250 a household. You've just added 300 households that are paying $700 a household. You just paid your debt service off while either be able to put more money into capital, because your operating costs don't increase substantially at a treatment facility.
So basically, though, what you're doing is you're just pushing the cost on to people that are
more people.
Are non-users at the moment.
You'd have a bigger base, correct?
Right. So basically, you're looking to expand the cost to non-users for the sake of generating cash.
I wouldn't say it's for the sake of generating cash. These figures here are from a wastewater strategic plan that was done by the town in the late 90s, roughly 20 years ago.
Correct.
At the time, they were looking to extend sewers into areas of septic system failures. So the two figures I've given you are the areas of septic system failures and then the areas of back in the late 90s.
When you say, Tony, in believe me, I'm just asking questions for information so I can process this whole thing. When you say septic system failures, are those failures just because of the life cycle? Or are those failures because of some preconditions that exist? Or I guess I don't understand with the map as far as some areas that have been known problem areas. I guess what I'm asking is what criteria was used to determine those were known problem areas? Because to be honest with you, one of those areas, my area, and I've been there for 40 years, and granted, people have replaced some septic systems, they've upgraded some septic systems, but usually it's when it's a buy or sell. There have been a few systems that have failed, but it's just because it's been the lifetime of the system. I mean, I've been in the area for 40 years, and I haven't seen system after system up in that area failing, you know, for some unknown reason. So I'm just wondering what criteria was used and who determined these areas.
So I can't speak to the actual study that was done. I was not at Weston and Sampson at the time that this study was done. Mm-hmm. But when we've done these studies for other communities in the Commonwealth, the criteria usually are soil types, because obviously the new Title V systems have a specific percolation rates, frequency of pumping. So we go to the health department, we pull records, and we physically plot them on a map. And if you see people pumping on a yearly basis or twice a year, sometimes you see people that will pump four times a year, that's an indication that they know they have a septic system problem. And the way of getting around having to replace your system is you just pump it more frequently. So that's a criteria you use. And another criteria you use, which I don't think is too much of a problem here in Deerfield, but is small lots. And then the other criteria you look at is the area wet. So there's a report, I know Kevin has a copy of it, that's about this thick that was done. I pulled these out of the report.
which are all in the selectmen's office.
Right, yeah. Now, like I say, I'm just wondering because, as I say, I've been up in that area for 40 years, and I have not heard or seen people pumping their tanks every year or two or three times a year or anything of that nature.
So when you sell your house in Massachusetts, you have to have a compliant Title V system.
Right.
So when you see people that, when they sell their house, they have to replace the system.
Right.
That tells you right there that that system was basically a failed system.
Right.
Yeah, but the key to that is that in the past 15 years, they've changed the rules. And I recently bought a piece of property, and it failed. The system failed. It didn't fail because it didn't work. It failed because the components didn't meet the new regulations. The house had a 1,000-gallon tank. The new regulation said it has to have a 1,500-gallon. So technically, the system failed. There was another piece of property near my house that just because no one lived there for 12 months, it technically failed. So, you know, there's a lot of things that really can skew these things.
And one question. On the Elm Street, Whately Road area.
Are we looking at the map?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry.
You have to tell me where that is. I don't know exactly where that is.
If I remember, and I'm vague at it. What's that?
Which map?
Elm Circle.
The one where they're checking off the Conway Road area where they think there'd be a lot of expansion. Okay. It's called figure B7.
Okay.
I'm not exactly sure because I'm getting old, okay? But I believe there's a sleeve under Interstate 91 that goes from Elm Street, so-called, through to Whately Road, which was Elm Street before 91. I believe there's a sleeve under there that the town paid to put under there when the highway was built. I can't say that it's there, but I believe it.
I've heard two stories on that. One is that the sleeve is under the Elm Street, and the second one is under Route 91 at Conway Road.
Yeah.
I don't know which
one. Either way, it's either Elm or Conway.
Yeah. And
It's one or the other, and they, I remember that going through and approving it back.
1959, 60, somewhere in there when the highways were cut out. My grandfather died in 62. I think it happened before that. But I can't swear to it, but I'm pretty sure that they fought to get those a sleeve put underneath there years ago. So if you go back to town meeting records, you may be able to find it.
Matter of fact, I got one of the maps that you gave me from your father, and I thought it showed it on that map.
It may very well.
I'm going to have to go back.
But I don't have it because I gave it to you.
I know.
Bruce?
Going back to the initial question, is that... Do you have any idea how many approximate users would be picked up from the Butterfly Museum north on a new section of Forest Main? Because by what I can, my recollection, there isn't a whole lot of buildings.
Not a lot of houses there.
No,
developable
no.
land.
Developable land.
From what I've seen on an aerial, and I should have done house counts. I didn't think to do that. From what I've seen on an aerial, when you end at the Butterfly Place to basically where the old Deerfield collection system starts, there's maybe five or six houses, and they look mostly like large farms.
Right.
Oh, wait.
So
the Butterfly?
From the end of the Butterfly Conservatory is where the gravity would start.
Right.
Heading to old Deerfield's collection system starts.
North.
Basically
along Route 5? Oh, I'll bet you there's 50 or 60 houses.
So you can't gravity out of your house?
Well, I could.
This way?
Yeah, I think I could.
So.
Because my house is higher than the Butterfly Place.
Now, do you live on North Hillside?
No, I live on Route 5.
He lives right across from the Butterfly Place.
Right on top of Long Hill.
So, yes, the Butterfly Place would be where gravity starts, and then it would get deep to basically come over... No, we come
down here.
Near Jackson
actually started
Road.
In front of your house because that's top of the hill.
They said it was designed initially to go all the way from the top of Long Hill, be gravity all the way back to South Deerfield Center. Which
Long Hill is where the...
Force main up to that point, and then whatever they have for storage or...
But from my house to, say, Richardson's Candy Kitchen, there's got to be 50 homes on there anyways. It doesn't seem like it, when you stop and you count how many houses are there.
You count the Wapping area, yeah, you got quite a few houses in there.
Yeah, there are.
It's closer to 30, I think.
Yeah, they're next to...
I tried, I don't know what you have.
Yeah.
Ask the answer.
I drove through there today. You can't know, I could have counted them.
As many along, all those condos, don't they each have individual systems?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's over by where the drive-in theater was and the Yankee Candle.
And they have an association, and if somebody's septic system fails, the whole association pays.
Most of them have failed over there, too.
Right, so, no, but I'm just talking about if the line was run down Mill Village rather than Route 5, you can definitely avoid the roadway.
That was what my point was before.
Yeah.
Would you be able to pick up the businesses on 5, though? I mean, that's kind of where your infrastructure, the future...
Well, is it going to be cost-effective, the thing, you know?
I mean, that's where the claim are in pursuit of right now. We have business selling, they don't pay. I'm just curious, like, if we're going to move it, not do our industrial...
Well, on Route 5 right there, I would assume you can get off the road. I mean, you have wide shoulders.
That's a 100-foot layout, I think, sure, isn't it?
I don't know that off the top of my head.
It's a good-sized layout.
I'm sure you can do it. I do know that on Route 5, you have a 10-inch or an 8, I think it's a 10-inch gas main on one side, then you got the water main on the other, and I know that they swap in different areas, exactly where, I don't know.
Well, let me ask you this. Can anybody tell me, going from say, like, your house south to, say, the fire station, how much land there can be developed?
Not much.
What is the capabilities of having something be built there? I mean, because if...
It's sewer. Yankee Candle put their own sewer system in.
Correct.
And Channing Beach got sewer, but it goes underneath the railroad tracks and goes over to North Main Street, and that was put in 35, 40 years ago, okay? And the rest of the land is the piece that the town owns north of the fire station, where the animal hospital is. There's some possibility that maybe some more private land. There's a bunch of land that's marginal to develop.
So what I'm trying to get at is how much business could go in there, and would the townspeople want business to go in there? Because what I'm looking at is like you said, I mean, if you're not going to go ahead and bring in any more business, if the town doesn't want any more business, then it would not make a whole lot of sense at that point to go ahead and sewer that direction.
Well, I think there would be a lot of resistance to development north of Long Hill.
Yeah.
Because that's old Deerfield.
Correct.
A lot of people would think that needs to be preserved because of what it is.
Of what it is.
Even coming down 5 and 10, I remember years ago that was being discussed, and the people were up in arms about anything being added to 5 and 10.
But so then
there are a lot of people are really concerned about that.
So I think we're really talking about from the top of Long Hill
to the fire station.
Right.
And that's what I was trying to ask is how much economic development could possibly be happening there. Right. And if it is, do your cost analysis to find out whether it's even worth...
Well, I mean, Jenny Beat owns a major section on one side of the road. And, you know, they have the ability to expand already because they have access to the sewer that goes over to North Main Street.
Right.
So I don't know if they have any plans to develop the rest of that land. Good strategic plan, they should have that in their mind, and they want to protect their interests and what have you. But as for the others, it's pretty much maxed out.
Okay.
We're deciding here which way we want to go.
Well, you know, they're saying that we might be better off running it down Mill Village Road.
I understand, but we don't even know if we want to even close old Deerfield down.
Our discussion kind of moved to...
Actually, what you guys are actually talking about is basically planning study. Because in a planning study, you'd look at two or three options of upgrading old Deerfield. And I'm going to get technical here and just kind of bear with me. Right now, Deerfield's, old Deerfield's a conventional activated sludge, 1970s technology. You could convert it to a membrane bioreactor where it's basically, they have clarifiers and we basically are filtering the effluent. You could convert it to a sequencing batch reactor where we basically batch each of the tanks. So there's a bunch of different treatment options that you could do at Old Deerfield. And the same goes for if you decided to shut it down and pump it. You could pump it to Greenfield. You could pump it to South Deerfield. And there's several different routes you could take. You could take Route 5 and 10.
Mm-hmm.
Or like you said, you could go through the Mill Village, or there could be a combination thereof.
If you tankered it, you pumped it out of the vats or the holding thing in Old Deerfield, you say it's 80,000 gallons a day?
Mm-hmm.
So that would have to, and you could put what, 10,000 gallons in a tanker?
What, are you thinking about hauling your wastewater out of there? And just have it as a holding tank?
I'm thinking out loud.
Can you do that?
Technically, you can.
That's it?
I said technically you can do that. He asked me, can you do that? And yes, the answer is technically you can do that. It becomes cost prohibitive because you're going to have to buy your own tankers. You're going to have to haul the tankers. And if you can get a 10,000-gallon tanker, you're now making 8 trips, dumping it in South Deerfield. You're paying for gas. You're paying for a truck. You're paying for maintenance. You're paying for a CDL driver. You're probably paying overtime because the flow doesn't come in all in one whack.
Plus, in the springtime, you might even not be able to get down there.
Yeah, but I'm just trying to think out of the box as to how we can solve the problem without...
Let's ask another question here.
Spending
what if we just did the upgrades and brought the old Deerfield plant in line with all the regulations and did the South Deerfield plant and brought South Deerfield in line with all the regulations, and that's the end of it?
That is an option you could also look at.
Can I make a suggestion, and it's just purely a suggestion, because it seems like a lot of the questions that I'm seeing here are all in what Tony spent a lot of time filling out. Would it be helpful to actually go through what you physically have here, and then that it would probably answer more questions because this would trigger more?
That's what we asked him to do.
So that's
right.
Purely a suggestion, not my committee.
Fine. It would be proper to do that.
I do have a question. No, you have to apologize. I have to apologize because a lot of this stuff that's just coming up right now was done 20 years ago. So I know I don't have a clue, okay? And it just keeps popping up. Every meeting we find another piece of history that somebody made commitments 20 years ago. And unfortunately, at least I'm totally behind the eight ball on this. So a lot of these questions that Weston Sampson has previously answered, we're just finding a piece of paper now showing up. So we have no history going back. Okay, so we're kind of fumbling around.
I felt this was very helpful.
I did too, and yeah. I really do appreciate it. And I haven't had a chance to read thoroughly, and unfortunately that's part and part of getting back to what Kevin's talking tonight. I guess one of the things I would like to see is a professional opinion as to prioritizing some of this stuff, and I thought that was more of what this meeting was going to be, because I think we're getting off in other tangents right now, and we'd like a professional opinion of the most serious problems and a priority list of those problems, so that we're going to have to work on a staging plan rather than an overall plan. Do you have any ideas on that, or have you put something together?
That was actually a question that was asked. But we did go through that. If you guys want, we can skip right to that question.
Oh, sure. I'm sorry.
I mean, I'm here as long as you guys need me to be here.
It's going to be a long night.
Hey, it's all right.
I was going to say, I hope it's not too
long. If it gets to 9 o'clock, somebody's got to get coffee. That's all.
What number do we want to look at?
You're looking at 4?
So if you go on to page 4 of 11, item 10, question that was raised, and I'll read it. For this part of the discussion, are there any items that need to be reprioritized for timeline of need? If so, please provide a new timeline, scope of services, and a revised fee. So Kevin and I, before this memo went out, Kevin and I sat down and actually went specifically through this item here. on prioritizing. The headworks upgrade at South Deerfield is desperately needed. I think we all can agree on that. Items B and C, Old Deerfield, either modernization or decommissioning, and Captain Lathrop Pump Station. Those are basically, Kevin, you can jump in at any time and hit me on the back of the head if you want.
Not yet.
I would say those are both the same priority, and they're high priority. I mean, Old Deerfield's 45 years old.
Right.
Treatment plants are designed for a 20-year life, typically have a 30-year useful life. I mean, just today, Keith was mentioning one of the aerators went, and he's having issues with bearings, and he's now being out-serviced. At some point, something's going to have to be done with Old Deerfield. And Captain Lathrop Pump Station is basically in the same boat. When I went over and saw Kevin, he literally, in his office, has the spare parts, some of the spare parts that they're putting in to keep that pump station
up and running.
Functional.
Because the other night, we spent 7.5 hours in there trying to make sure that the people on Captain Lathrop did not have backup going into their house. Because if that system fails, bare minimum at present flow, and these are just ballpark because I'm not an engineer, but you're going to have probably about 4 hours and you're going to have raw sewage going into people's basements.
What keeps happening over there?
It's the electronics. The electronics are from, I don't know when they put it in. Obviously, whoever put in the cheapest model they possibly could, and it's failing. It's not even low bid, because my understanding is the contractor put that in.
It's what I would call contractor grade, which is you got municipal grade. I wouldn't even know what to call the next grade. Then you have contractor grade. It's get in, get out. Go on to the next project.
But I mean,
in most of the stuff that's in there, yeah, I can't get parts for anymore. The only thing I can really get parts for right now is the floats. Everything else, because the way it stands right now, is when we had an issue with it last year, when we physically had to have a person stand there every 4 minutes and hit the bypass button to allow the pump to run until we got an electrician in on a weekend. That particular thing cost us ballpark about $3,000 over a simple relay that they can't get anymore. No. So then what they did was they hodgepodged in there to get me through.
I don't know enough, so I want to learn if I can. You know, I've put in probably a dozen pump systems, and I happen to own one of the oldest ones that I've done. It's 13 years old, and it pumps roughly 250 gallons a day. Not a lot. But it's been there 15 years, and I've never done a darn thing to it. What? No, they're all over town. I don't have a problem with them. What is it? What's different that I am missing
between what I'm doing? But I'd be more than willing to allow you to come by and take a peek at what we have.
Yeah, I mean,
the casing, the box itself is rotting.
Yeah.
I mean, it's past its useful life. You get a pair of sneakers, holes in them. The laces wrap out. I mean, how often do you keep replacing this stuff until you finally look at it and say, you know what?
Yeah.
It's costing me more money here. It's uncomfortable. It's not working right. Get rid of it and buy a new pair of sneakers.
Well, it sounds to me like that needs to be moved up on a priority list.
But
in relationship to this.
But you're also looking at your decommissioning or bringing that plant back up to where it should be, Old Deerfield. That's a higher priority only because it services so many more people. This year, I can continue to limp this thing along. But, again, it's not very cost effective.
The big question with that pump station is, and if you ask me my opinion, it's going to be option two. Option one is you replace any kind with a brand new pump station, or option two, you lay a deeper sewer and you eliminate the pump station altogether, because a sewer's got a 100-year useful life.
And that was $1 million compared to 1.5, I believe, in your figures.
Actually, I think I put a number together.
How much would it cost just to do, if it was $1 million to replace that pump station?
No.
I think it was like 800,000 plus fees would be close to a million.
What's the capacity of that tank there, Kevin, that pump is in? I mean, is it 1,000 gallons, 2,000 gallons?
There's no records that are there.
Yeah. Is it 8 by 8 feet or bigger than that?
It's basically, it's a...
Six by six by 30.
Yep, 30 feet long or deep?
And basically what it does is we have, let's see, bear with me half a second. The pump is probably 2.5 feet tall. The top of it sticks out. So I'm looking at the base of that unit right there is usable water, 6 feet, 8 feet, roughly.
And so, and it just cycles, that must have a float. When it gets to the top, it starts, and when it gets down to the bottom, it just shuts off. Is that how it works?
Well, it actually works off of pressure, but yeah, because they used to have a float system, and that failed.
Same concept, so yes.
So they upgraded it to a pressure system, and basically you're only talking a 10-inch, 10 to 12-inch lift back and forth. You get 10 or 12 inches worth of stuff in there, it pumps it down. And then it stops. And then you get another, and it pumps it down. It doesn't fill that whole 30 feet or 25 feet of, because your pipe is down low. You know, if you wanted to increase it, you'd put in a deeper tank where your inlet going into the tank is much higher than what it is right now.
Yeah, typically you want to have about 3 feet, because that gives you some time. If you get a call, you don't all of a sudden right. have a problem on your hands.
But you know, if you drop that thing another 20 feet, maybe the thing only will run once a week.
So basically, it's starting and stopping on a 12-inch,
roughly,
difference in elevation.
12, 14 inch.
That's going to burn your motors out.
Yeah. Well, that's what I was saying. It seems like if you had a float system, it seems like it would be better and let the thing go 30 inches at a time.
But I can't go 30 inches, because I go 30 inches, it's above the woody-call, and now I'm starting to flood houses.
You want to keep a 12-inch difference between where the pipe comes
from. Oh, I understand that, but it's not deep enough where you could...
No. Once again, it's because whoever put the system in, put it in as cheap as possible. It was the cheapest system that could possibly be put in with the least amount of excavation, the least amount of pipe. This, my general understanding, I could be wrong, but the same person that did that did the same job on Kelleher, and we had an issue between the two culverts or between the two catch basins. We couldn't figure out why the center of the road kept caving in. We opened it up, pipe here, there was a gap this deep in between. It wasn't that it was rotted. They went ahead, they put a sign over the top of it, and then they put a grain bag over the top of that. That's the mentality of what was being done at that point in time when all of these things were being done. Cheap, quick, fast, get out. Mm-hmm. And now we're paying the price for it, is the easiest way of trying to say it.
Well, unfortunately, the people that put all that stuff in are no longer around.
No.
Okay? And, Kelleher Drive, I happen to live there, so I've experienced some of the problems there. But I wonder if you'd put a deeper tank, whether or not you could put a deeper tank at Captain Lathrop, because the water table is so high.
Right. Maybe that's why they went with a shallow tank. Yeah. Again, I don't know.
You may be able to put a wider tank or bigger tank to hold more, but I don't know that you can go much lower than where you are, probably because of the brooks there, and it's an awful high water table.
When you look at a life cycle versus a pump station versus a gravity sewer, every 20 years, pump station, mechanical, every 20 years you should be replacing electrical, you should be replacing controls, you should be replacing pumps. Even if the structures themselves are in fine shape, you've got $100,000, $200,000 in costs, plus you have man hours for your guys to go there. They should be checking them at least twice a week. You've got man hours for them to unclog the pumps from rags. You've got annual electrical costs. When you look at the life cycle costs of a pump station versus a gravity sewer, especially when you're only talking 1,500, 2,000 feet of sewer, it's almost, when you look at it over a 100-year life cycle, you do the pump station four times in the time you do that gravity sewer.
So would you recommend that at annual town meeting, the Board of Selectmen ask the town to take easements along one side of that Bloody Brook going up through to eventually put the line up through?
What I had, honestly, what Kevin and I had talked about was actually going under the brook, getting into, what's the street there?
North Main.
Getting into North Main Street and then replacing gravity sewer from there all the way to Kelleher. because Kevin actually went out with the guys, they were doing some work in the road, he popped all the manholes and we got rough depths. It looks like it can flow by gravity there. You have roughly a fifth, Kelleher is roughly elevation 200, where Captain Lathrop ties into North Main Street is roughly elevation 215, so you got 15 feet of depth to play with right there. And I want to say, Kev, correct me if I'm wrong, it's roughly 12 feet deep.
Roughly.
At Kelleher, and it's like 4 feet deep at Captain Lathrop?
Yeah, 6 feet, yeah, roughly.
So you're talking between just natural grade change and depth of sewer, you got 27 feet to play with.
So you're saying that that sewer line comes up that much in that short a distance?
Yep.
From what I was told, the sewer runs deep to Frontier Regional and was supposed to go deep all the way to get on the other side of the railroad bridge. But this town was running out of money, so they raised the sewer up at Frontier once it transitioned beyond Frontier Regional.
Well, we'll talk about that. I mean, couldn't you, if that was the case, and where's that sewer? Right in front of Kelleher and the school is 12?
It's coming up. As soon as, if you're actually looking at the corner itself, as soon as you come around Bloody Brook Corner, the very first one right there, that's right there, just before the driveway going into Frontier, that's the deep one. As soon as you start going from there, it raises up dramatically.
Well, so then couldn't you go from that point and just dig right along the road?
That's what he was saying.
You could, but I don't know pitch-wise, grade-wise, so I assumed you'd have to go back to Kelleher just for this level.
Well, Kelleher Drive sewer is actually fed on the other side of the brook over by the monument. I believe that's where it ties in.
That's correct.
It doesn't tie in right out at the end of the street.
Correct.
Okay? It doesn't get pushed under there. It goes in front of old Tim Kelleher's house. That's where it comes. In fact, when you built when they shored the thing up 4 or 5 years ago, that's where they found it, right? And
yeah, it was more than five.
Maybe it's 10 now.
I've been here 6 years, and it was long before I was here.
Well, anyway. But if you go all the way up through, maybe that would work. I think the reason they stopped with the sewers way back then is the water table in town was so high. And if you go back and you look at some of the stuff that's recorded in the Registry of Deeds about with the plans and what have you, they talk about the test pits and where they got water, et cetera. And you may be able to find all that information in the registry because they do say test pit such and such. They make references to where they were. So it could be very well that the water table was so high and it may have been the contractor wanted an extra to pump it. And that's maybe why they did it. I don't know.
That's
don't know any more than that. But I do know that they pumped an awful lot of, they had pumps in behind the Polish Club in South Deerfield, from what I understand, way back there, because the line goes between George Grimaki's old building and the old drugstore. The line goes through there. And they had pumps. And you'll find some of those stuff, and if you go look at that reference in a registry of deeds, you'll see where they mention test pits.
The entire Pioneer Valley has a clay layer that's roughly anywhere from 7 to 12 feet deep, which basically acts like a pressurized artesian well, and once you puncture that layer, the water flows, and it flows substantially.
Well, it depends on where you're at.
Yeah, it varies roughly 7 to 12 feet depending on where you are, but once you break through it for an excavation, it comes up under pressure, so it becomes a water handling situation.
On your estimate for this headworks improvement, new headworks facility, dated August 1st, 2016. It says headworks building now. Is that included in the numbers that are here?
Yes. This,
it doesn't actually say there is. I guess one of the things that kind of blew my mind was $300,000 for a generator for that facility?
For a treatment plant? I just put one in similar size of what you're going to need for the town of Great Barrington, Massachusetts.
How many kilowatts was it?
I don't know off the top of my head. I want to say it was a 500.
500.
And that would provide power when we lost power?
It would provide power for the entire treatment facility as required by Mass DEP.
Which presently, right now, we do not.
Now, reading this, that's only for the generator, it does not include updating the motor control center and/or the transfer switches or anything, no?
No, that is included under miscellaneous electrical work.
Oh, okay. Okay, because somewhere in there, I remember reading that it was going to be utilizing the existing transfer switch.
Correct.
So that...
The switch itself, we're going to change a breaker out in it to make it run. We have to change the, oh, I'd have to look at the plans. I want to say the plant has a 600 amp rated electrical service, but you have to derate it by, so it's only able to run roughly 400 amps. With the new electrical building, excuse me, with the new headworks building, we're right at the trip level, so we have to upgrade everything one breaker size. And then when we're putting the generator in, we size the generator for what you have today to run the entire treatment plant, plus we put in reserve so that if you do upgrade the treatment plant in the future, or if you're required to do nitrogen removal in the future, you don't have to go out and buy another.
So that would be replacing the motor control center as well?
No, just doing, changing breakers out in buckets, rewiring things, not replacing the entire motor control center.
So that wouldn't replace the motor control center in either one of those buildings down there?
No.
That aren't even brand names that you can't even get parts for anymore?
Keith, you could probably talk better about getting parts for the motor control center.
No, they're obsolete, I've been already told numerous times.
I saw them, yeah.
That they don't make parts for them anymore, and that...
So that's not including that? That could very easily run another 100,000?
That'd be more than that.
The ones in the lower building are even older than the ones in the newer building.
Yeah, I think those were hot point or something. I've never even heard of hot point made motor control centers.
General Electric, probably.
Don't they make stoves?
Yeah, but that's not under...
So under the modernization approach, our recommendation would be to build a separate electrical building, get the MCCs out of the operations building where Keith's office is, and get the MCCs...
So none of that's even included in there?
No, you would do that as part of your modernization upgrade, but we've set the facility up such that if you do the modernization upgrade, everything ties into it. You're not throwing things out.
But that doesn't have to be a real fancy building, right?
No, it's just the...
It's going to be a shell to hold it and to exhaust the gas.
You're not talking a massive building there, no.
So this proposal here is just, for this $300,000 generator, is just tying it into a bunch of older equipment?
On that modernization of that plant, what would happen to the two aerator tanks?
The aeration tanks?
Yeah.
You would replace the aeration system, do some minor concrete work. I wouldn't build new tanks.
Okay. Have you ever looked into draining one of the tanks at a time, or however you can lower it, drying out, and just epoxy lining it?
I haven't looked into that, but I have done that at other facilities. It's not, I mean, you it can be done.
Oh, yeah.
So here's your current sewage treatment plant. Operations building, aeration basin one, aeration basin two, 60-foot diameter secondary clarifier. These are your existing rectangular secondary clarifiers that you use as an emergency condition because they, for lack of a better term, don't really work. Sludge storage and handling facilities. So you have to go over here. So here's your new standby generator. Replacing what breakers we need to replace in the MCC, you're doing as minimal work as possible. New electrical line, we're putting in an electrical handhole here so that in the future you can put an electrical building right here. You bring a new electric service, new transformer, which your current transformer sits right here. So you can build all your electrical offline so the plant would stay operational. You build your electric offline, then you fire the systems up and redo them as you go. So we've set the system completely up so that in the future, if, when you do a modernization upgrade,
you'd have an electrical building go right there, a couple power panel boards. I wouldn't personally, I don't like MCCs. I like to have power panel boards and individual motor starters, just a belt suspenders approach. It's not substantially more expensive. And bring up the additional secondary clarifier. Right there. So let's today's permit. Let's throw out the future. At some point in the future, maybe not even in my lifetime, they're dealing with it now in Connecticut, nitrogen removal will be required in the state of Massachusetts. It's going to be required almost everywhere in the country. Let's assume next 20 years we're not going to get nitrogen removal. The only drill upgrades you would be looking at in South Deerfield, a second one of these, so you have redundancy, and I'm sure Keith, you can talk to just when you try to just run these clarifiers, it's a struggle just to maintain permit.
Completely.
Replacing your aeration system, putting in some sort of a diffused aeration system, they're more energy efficient. You would be looking at rebates from the power utility. And the headworks building in new electrical. I mean, this is what your modernization upgrade. You don't have an issue with capacity. The plant does roughly 500,000 gallons a day. It's permitted for 800,000. You may look at doing something solid handling wise, but that might depend whether Montague's plant comes online or not. You know, that would just be a purely cost benefit analysis. I mean, these are really the big three you're looking at, your big capital costs, the new clarifiers, the headworks building, and then whatever you end up doing with electrical. Electrical is tricky in the state of Massachusetts because the bidding laws under Chapter 149 require what's called a filed subbid because they want to. They did it to make it to try to get better pricing, but what actually ends up happening is the electrical prices end up being 25-30% inflated because there's only a certain amount of contractors that'll bid on.
The new clarifier is.
No, it would go right into service, trust me. The old one would be the backup, and it's already over 30 years old. And everything is in that basket. We really don't have a backup right now at all. And it's in dire need of some professional servicing. I actually had Dor Oliver come out 2 weeks ago and take a look at it. A representative came from Pennsylvania and looked at it to see if I could get some kind of manufacturing service to get us through another 10 years maybe, but it's really old and there are things that are gonna need to be replaced. And as of right now, we don't have a backup, a real backup for that at all.
I understand that. I was just wondering if we couldn't just refurbish the existing one and refurbish the two rectangular ones to be a backup.
Problem with the rectangular ones is they're just undersized.
Yeah, they are. Just so like old Deerfield.
You're going to be, technical term, puking solid, where you can only really put out 30 milligrams per liter post-spent solids. As your flows fluctuate throughout the day, the rectangulars get a hydraulic load and they wash some of the solids out, so you run the risk of having a solid
body. Yeah, and we're experiencing that at old Deerfield every month. We're always teetering on the edge. Because of that same
we
thing.
Have sufficient land to take care of whatever you're going to need to put there.
Your property line currently right here, this survey was done as part of the headworks project, so yes, without going into this farm field right here, you have sufficient room to put in another clarifier and put in a return pumping building.
What if you had to do the nitrogen stuff, what do you have to put in for infrastructure for that?
So, if you have to do nitrogen, what I was envisioning is you'd be building new tanks here,
okay. And
you'd be building another set of tanks right here.
So you have zoned aeration.
No, we have enough property to do it.
Correct.
Okay.
That's the question.
I have to tell you, though, that second new circular clarifier is dangerously close to the river.
Yeah.
So,
And if that was our main one in service, because it would be the newer one, and we had a huge spring thaw, we could actually be jeopardizing.
This is the top of the clarifier, which involved 100-year elevation back in the year. It could actually be a retaining wall.
It was a year, Mike.
Back in, I thought it was in the '70s.
That was the.
Okay, good.
Tony Coker called and says, hey, come over, we're trying to.
I'm impressed. I'm glad you could do that.
I was in the truck with Dave Bahanowitz. Dave Bahanowitz was driving, and I was co-pilot, and we were backing in over that. And Dave says to me, get what happens if this collapses? I said, we're done. Well, we'd go right into the trees. I think that was the year Amy got married. I don't know what year it was. She's got, you know, probably 30 years ago.
Now that we've done the South Deerfield plant, what about the old Deerfield plant? Could you more or less go over the same as far as what would need to be done as far as upgrades for the old Deerfield plant?
Capacity is not an issue at the old Deerfield plant. You'd be replacing mechanical equipment, you'd be replacing the electrical, you'd be doing basically completely gutting the building.
What about the clarifiers?
You don't have to. My recommendation would be to build at least one
circular.
Mm-hmm. The inflow pump station is going to need some work. You might have to try to jerry rig a screen in there. That thing's very, very deep. It's just, you know, similar stuff you're looking at here, just on a much smaller scale.
Okay.
But this thing's roughly five times the size of the old deer.
Right, old deer field. The other issue that I see with old Deerfield also is, and I think this kind of gets overlooked a lot, the erosion taking place on Little Meadow Road going to the plant from DA is getting critical. And now would be a good time to go check it out for yourself. Go down the road when all the leaves are gone. You'll see just how close that erosion line is to the road itself. And that's on the cut bank side of the river. So unless that's shored up, it's going to continue over time to the road. And all it's going to take is a couple more big storms like we had with Irene to really do a job on it. I don't know what would happen at that point. I mean, sure, it's up on a knoll, but getting in and out of there might really be a problem. And for sludge haulers, they need to come and pick it up, and employees and everyone else, really. It's.
I believe there was some comment made earlier that probably would not be eligible for any kind of grants.
The erosion control?
With that plant being in the flood zone.
Ah, okay.
I think there was a comment made that, so that might be something that would be on our own anyway.
Even USDA?
Well, I don't know.
USDA, we actually met with USDA to talk about funding for whatever wastewater infrastructure you guys end up doing, and you are eligible based on the town population is the first criteria. The second criteria is town income, and there you have three, low, medium, and high, and you actually qualify as a low-income community, so you're eligible for an interest rate of roughly 1.5%.
Cheap.
And also eligible for up to a 45% grant based on those. But the third factor they look at, which was one of the reasons why the rate study was done and the rates were increased, was sewer rates as percent of median household income. USDA's first benchmark when it comes to percentage of grant versus percentage of loan is where do you stand as percent median household income? They want to see the wastewater utility at roughly between 1% and 1.5%. The higher percentage, the more grant eligible you are.
And they go off of your median income?
They go off the townwide median in household income. Previously, you were right below, I think we were at 0.75%, and with your rate increase, you're like right at 1%.
With this rate they just passed for the FY15.
So this last rate that just went through.
That only brought us up a quarter.
The grant.
Yeah, that would still make us under 1%.
But when you go to do your upgrade, there's going to be debt service associated with that upgrade. That's when they would then check, okay, when you do your upgrade, you're going to be at 1.4%.
Yeah. Well, then again, if you go by that rate that we said, I'm just calculating that minimum rate that we had was only is less than 1%, but that's only for 20%. So do they go by your average rate? So then that would be, because once you get into the middle of the pack.
They look at your median rate.
Yep.
And these were all things when we were looking at, when we, I personally didn't, I helped the town on the sewer study, the rate study, I personally didn't do any of the work, but that was one of the things that was talked about when, you know, the previous town administrator, Doug Finn, when he was looking at the different rates, was, hey, we know we got capital coming, let's try to set our rates so that when the time does come, we look good for USDA. Because I've had communities that are extremely below the poverty line, that they were basic, their sewer rates were about 0.2% of their median household income, and USDA looked to them and literally said, we're not giving you any grant, even though you're one of the poorest communities in the state, because you can afford to raise your rates to 1%. It's just the way, it's the benchmark that the federal government uses. So I know we've jumped around. You guys want to just start going?
You got jumping around a lot.
This is how my brain actually works, so this is easy for me.
This is easy, right, though?
Chasing a 5-month-old and a 2-year-old.
So this is like a night off.
It's a night off, exactly.
Now wait till they get to be 15 and 16 and they go faster.
Do you want us to give you a note so you can stay out later?
I think what we'll do is just, I don't want to read all the questions, but we'll just say, you know, question one, give you guys a chance to read it, and then if we have any questions, we'll just kind of work our way down that way.
Well, we didn't already spoke to the old Deerfield plant, kind of what it needed and stuff.
So with the upgrades on the old Deerfield plant, we're talking maybe approximately $5 to $7 million. But to address Keith's concern about that possible erosion, is there anything that we can do about that as far as a town?
I don't know.
I'm just wondering, you know, as far as...
In the past, there's every major erosion problem that we've had, you know, I believe the state's come in to help,
right,
whether it be on River Road or along Mill Village Road.
Yeah. Well, I was just wondering if that's something that we could possibly pursue to to make that feasible to keep the old Deerfield plant.
I don't know. I know that I went to one meeting and the folks from USDA did offer all kinds of financing and grants, like they said.
Right.
And I knew that we were eligible for quite a bit. I don't know if they would go into, you know, building a dike or something. I don't know how far they go.
Right, yeah. Because I know they shored up at the old Deerfield plant there, that bank, for the erosion.
They didn't go far.
And so if they, that's what I was wondering, if there's any possibility of coming back to shore the rest of that up to make it safe for the future, to refurbish the old
right Deerfield. In front of the plant. That was right. Outstanding. It still is.
Mm-hmm.
Once you get right to the end of where that improvement ends, there's an inlet there that actually is a reconnection from the river comes down from the opposite the plant, and some of it goes around an island and then comes back around this way. And it's right at that point it's cutting dramatically in toward the road there. So it needs to be extended. Or something similar needs to be done there.
Right. I just wonder if that was a possibility to be able to refurbish that old Deerfield plant, so that will address the concerns as far as being able to get in and out.
I would hate to see all this money spent on the plant infrastructure.
And then not be able to access
all
it. Right.
The roads. And,
that's,
that would be
kind of really agree with you there.
Because Deerfield Academy's main, Deerfield Academy's main that comes down is just on the opposite side of that. Would be on the opposite side of the river, of that roadway. so you're only talking another, in some areas, you're only talking another 40, 45 feet, and your sewer will be in the river.
Yeah.
I don't know exactly what was going on with the theories of trying to do riverbank restoration there. My general understanding is it was huge, huge money. It was something that, that to the point that they didn't even look at. I don't have any particulars on it. I was not involved in it. I'm just going off of what
when I was told. There, Bernie Kubiak, the former town administrator, and a whole conservation committee, and quite a few people, board of selectmen, all met down there at one point to look it over and try to come up with some kind of plan to fix that and remedy it. They were looking to DA to extend their to pay for some of it again, and I think DA did fork out the majority of $400,000 for what was in front of the plant, and then they were going to try to make the rest up with grant money. None of it ever materialized, and I never got any information from Don Chappelle, the former chief operator, about the status on that. So I have no idea where that went.
Well, is this something that we could check into? Because like you say, Keith, and I have a tendency to agree, if we're not going to be able to address that issue, then is it even worthwhile trying to upgrade the old Deerfield plant? And I think that's something that we need to find out if it's doable or not to reinforce that riverbank so we could just upgrade the old Deerfield plant to keep it online.
The road appears to be little used, but it is actually quite heavily used.
Mm-hmm.
Not only by sludge haulers, but by most of the residents of Old Deerfield come and go constantly, jogging, walking babies, tourists. Right. The annual reunion they have at DA, they like to come down there, and I mean, it's almost constant. The farmer there with dump trucks coming and going all summer right. long. It's just, it's
to me,
quite used.
Yeah. Right. To me, the first step would be to determine if we were able to reinforce that or not.
I think the first step, why do we want to keep it?
I think I'd have to agree with you. If it's going to be $10 million to put a force main and pump it into Deerfield, or $10 million to upgrade a plant that's going to need to be refurbished in 20 years, is against
the... And you've got to pay the operating costs.
And your operating costs is against one pump station.
Right.
I mean, I don't see where...
But you're still going to you're still going to be collecting this stuff at that plant. Am I right?
You'd have a pump station somewhere where the two trunk lines come together and pumping it to South Deerfield. So we've had discussions on this. They would like to keep the third operator, but technically you wouldn't need a specific operator for that. You could use it for maintenance in South Deerfield. Operational cost for electricity to run a brand new pump station is minimal. Like you said, Kip, you've got pump stations you put in 10 years ago, you haven't had any problems with them. Over 20 years you put that pump station in, with the new, you know, you'll be replacing pumps and working on pumps here and there, but nothing major. And the cost of treating the wastewater in South Deerfield, your costs aren't going to go up by a factor of 20%. I mean, your electricity will go up a little bit, but you get the more flow you have coming to a plant, the more economies of scale you get.
But you're also going to have to build, you know, somewhere down the road. You're talking nitrogen. You'd have to do that up there as well.
Yep.
And everything else. So, I mean, if your costs are equivalent one way or the other, it sounds like we don't have a choice.
If your life cycle costs, again, I'm speaking frankly, if your life cycle costs over a 20 or 30-year period are within 20 or 30%, and it's a little bit more to pump it, that's the way you go.
Yeah.
Because when you look at it over the long haul, the force main's 100 years, the gravity sewer's 100 years, the pump station structures you're going to get 20 to 50 years out of.
Right.
Besides the pump station up in the old Deerfield, are you going to have to maintain anything else?
Just the
solar panels.
You've got those. But you've also the collection system itself, which you'd have to do anyway.
Well, solar panels are owned by the town, aren't they?
Yeah.
But
that could actually add to that.
The pump station could be constructed knowing where it's located. it could actually be built up around so it was even higher than the current plant.
You could do that, or you could relocate it to an area that's out of the floodplain. And just do a little bit of reworking of the gravity sewers. It's all farmland right there. It's easy digging.
It might be easier getting permits as well, too.
I didn't want to mention that, but I can see Old Deerfield under today's permitting environment taking several years to get. You might have to even go to Army Corps.
I mean, right. And that's quite a few thousand dollars worth of just permitting fees.
I mean,
as well as research by engineers.
This number's assuming construction. I mean, you could have, and I'm not exaggerating because we've done some of these projects where the permitting is $1 million.
Exactly.
Just between
that's a major thing to take into consideration.
And it's only going to get worse as we go forward into time.
And it's not a guarantee that there's going to be allowed to begin with. It's a guarantee that it's going to raise construction costs right through the roof when they get done.
I don't see any benefit to keeping the old plant.
I don't either.
I don't see one benefit.
No, not from, you know, if it's going to cost within a couple million dollars, a couple million dollars, that's over the long haul. I think that's throwing money away to rejuvenate that.
So assuming you didn't get any grant from USDA, ballpark, for every $1 million you bond over a 40-year period, your debt service is roughly $40,000.
Debt service per month?
Per million. Annual. So if you did a $10 million project, you'd be looking at $400,000 a year in debt service. That's a 30-year term. A 20-year term is $60,000. So every time you add 10 years, you take 20 grand off.
Could you give that again?
30-year term, no grant. For every $1 million, you'd be looking at $40,000 a year in debt service.
What kind of interest rate would that be approximately?
2%.
That'd be about 2%?
About 2%, which if you go Mass DEP SRF, you're talking a 2% loan only. If you go USDA, you get the poverty rate, which is what they've already said you're eligible for. That's a 1.5, and it's been dropping. And I would assume you're going to get at least a 25% grant, because that's typically what everybody gets.
25%?
25%.
How do they figure we're in the poverty?
They go
when our median income is so much higher than this.
Because they count the students.
So you see that?
That's a good thing.
You see that? The schools are saving us money.
it goes by popular, yeah.
Sorry. I had to say it.
You don't ask those questions unless you know what the answer is. Okay?
I'm not questioning that.
Okay, if you look at Amherst, they probably are uber grant eligible because the students don't make any income and there's 20,000 at UMass.
That's backwards.
Well, I thought Hampshire College was going to close down now. They're all going to therapy. I don't know.
Oh.
Well, it sounds to me like we're...
You mean since last Tuesday?
Yeah. Yeah,
it's a possibility.
Sounds to me like we come full circle and maybe go back to what Jack talked about.
Somewhere going
to space. At the beginning is to... try to talk to some of the not-for-profits to help along with this, because they're going to be the biggest benefiter. And, you know, regardless of how it comes about, there's going to have to be some sort of input from the town. And just for a couple numbers here, I mean, your valuations in this town, profits and nonprofits, all total valuation in this town by assessor's records, about $953 million, almost $1 billion. And the properties that are on town sewer, and unfortunately I didn't have time to go all the way through, that does include some of the open lands and so forth that goes along sewer mains. Right now, the valuation is about $477 million. Of that $1 billion is properties that are long sewers. And of that, the, if you want to call them tax exempts, you have approximately $230 million of that is tax exempts. Now, that does include all your town properties, your state properties, you know, your tax exempts up there and so forth, so.
It's 40% somewhere in there.
So, you know, that's you know, that's almost half of the total valuation of the property that is on town sewer. So, unfortunately, you know, putting it on the tax burden is putting it on a very small percentage of the people, unfortunately. So, I think we really do need to try to have a concerted effort.
But how about, you know, especially with if we talk about closing the old Deerfield plant and pumping it, and we still have that $10,000 figure. Mm-hmm. A lot of that, I feel a lot of that could be eaten up in the rates that we charge, because we're not going to be laying this money out all at once. It's going to be over time. I don't know. I'm just picking numbers out of the sky here. But let's just say we had to pay, you know, $400,000 a year on this, you know, bond. If we were able to get $200,000 from the institutional rate in there, they would be, in a sense, paying half of that, you know?
Oh, I
know we couldn't make it
right.
Crazy, but...
Right, you know, but I'm just saying, yeah. I'm just saying I'm not expecting them to, you know, do it. And right. The rates are definitely going to have to go up for everybody.
Sure.
There's no doubt, no ands, ifs, or buts about it. And that's going to be the best distribution of the cost is through rates.
But I think that's a good area where, although I was in favor of the town keeping a steady... consistent tax rate, you know, between commercial and residential. I think this is an area where you could charge industrial, commercial, institutional, different than the residential. And then you'd also have to, you know, it kind of gets back to our whole study, like, well, you know, are their dorms considered residential or is that, you know, institutional?
Well, I personally, I think that's, you know, we don't have enough business base to start penalizing businesses. And unfortunately, in today's, you know, the business we have in town, the original owners are all long gone. They're from other parts of the country, and they could care less whether they stay in Deerfield or not.
Right, and I understand.
So you've got to be very, very careful with that one.
I'm not suggesting that, you know, it'd be outrageous, but still, if you look at what these companies are paying, you know, some of them for their sewer rates compared to other things that they might be paying. It's the same thing like we spoke about, you know, what a homeowner pays for their sewer rate compared to their cell phone bill. You know, you could apply that same logic to some of the businesses. It's not, I mean, their property taxes are pretty steep, but their sewer use taxes is not that much.
Well, it kind of has a dual-edged sword, because and maybe we should get back and utilize Mr. Simone's time rather than getting into this discussion. But
when you guys are talking rates and users, something to keep in mind is Frontier Regional hasn't, I don't know if the never is the correct word, but from what I was, my understanding was they've never paid a sewer bill.
Well, they have.
You're wrong.
Yeah, they're wrong.
They paid a flat rate.
A flat fee, but that's changing next year. So
that was something that we worked with town administrator Doug Finn on. He had noticed that.
But he made that statement, and I produced the bill where the town, because I'm on the Frontier Regional School Committee, okay. And Frontier did receive a bill, and they did pay it.
Right.
The biggest problem is they have an irrigation system that's separately metered, and they have to make sure that one offsets the other when it goes out. What's used domestically, they owe the money, and they should pay it. But anything that's used out in the ball fields, it's a different story.
Okay. Well, see, every other commercial or industrial does not get that benefit. And that's part of the inequity of the system.
Don't
they get, if they're used 125% more in the summer, they get it?
That only pertains to residential properties.
Well, my concern on this whole thing was simple. Back when I was a selectman, I used to complain all the time because I get a two-family house on Elm Street, and I was paying $700 for a bill on Elm Street. And at that time, Frontier took their water reading, subtracted off their reading for the fields, and when they got through, they're paying $1,200. Now, I'm paying $700 for five people, and they're paying $1,200 for 700 people. There's something wrong there.
Yeah.
And all I was saying, let's fix it, but we never got to fix it.
Well,
and it still is not fixed.
Oh, it is. Well, it will be.
It will be. That's good.
Yeah. They're going to change that after.
I think that's great.
Could I just ask a question? And maybe I should know this number, but at the new rates, how much income would come from Old Deerfield, from the three schools and the 30 houses? How much?
Additional income?
Well, how much total?
How much is it as a percentage of the total?
I didn't bring my figures. I know that we were going to generate.
Well, I think we got that information. Somebody got the information. We got an email with it. I just don't have it in front of me.
I didn't bring it with me tonight.
But if you go back and look, you may find that we already have it.
Right.
But with the change of the rates, basically increased revenue of $85,000 this year.
I think they use. Well, I'm not going to say anything.
You just got to go back and check the billings and total them up and see what they are.
Because what I'm getting at is if whichever way we go, we spend $10 million and the debt service is $400,000 a year. In effect, we're borrowing $10 million to service three customers, and the town's going to spend $400,000 a year to do that.
It's not cost effective.
But no. Now there's income. That's my question. Is the income $200,000 a year? Is it?
No, but that's what my point was about adjusting that, because you're right. You know, it's unfair. It's no different than what's been happening at Frontier. It's unfair for the rate payers to absorb that type of payment, you know, for, you know, a small amount of the users. I think the old Deerfield, and I don't know how it was broken down. So I basically, it was only about 20%, 18 to 20%. From the old Deerfield area.
Yeah, I was going to say that was my understanding of the figure. Yeah. It was roughly 20%.
But I think we could segregate the cost and have a separate rate for that system as to this system if costs were properly apportioned.
You could. You could do that because that's not a gravity system. You could say it's a pump system. It was more expensive to put in.
Yeah.
I think that's
Can we fair. Do that if it's going to the same plant? Can we legally do that, have two different rates? What does the state say we can and can't do as far as?
So when we pay legal counsel to figure out.
When the town was looking at the rate study, that was something that was discussed, having a possible capital fee for one system and then whatnot. But that's kind of as far as that got. It never advanced beyond that because, like you said, absolutely. You got to make sure what you're doing is legal under the general laws.
It just seems like we have a very unique situation in Old Deerfield. It's very different from the rest of the town.
Yeah, speaking frankly, I don't know why in the town's right mind they would have wanted to put that treatment plant in and own it in the 70s. I would have told
them. Because we were given the money and they said put it in there because you got a group of houses there and you need to support them.
Yeah.
And most of it was paid by grant. But now we got to maintain it and we haven't done that.
Let me toss another one out there, Michael. What if you just go ahead, like at one point in time, I can't remember exactly who said, make it two districts. Make your wastewater two districts, and whatever happens in Old Deerfield has to pick up 100%.
Yeah, that's
not bad.
But the question is what is that going to do to the 30 people that are not the big three? What are you going to do with those people? Are those people going to, because I know continually, questions have been asked about, well, what is this going to do to the elderly? What is this going to do to this person? How is this going to run them out of town? How much is this going to cost them? It's going to cost them more money to have their sewer than it will be to make a mortgage payment. You know.
But the thing about it is that the amount of water usage that those 30 people are using compared to the three institutions is maybe less than 5%.
I was actually going to say, I was just doing rough math in my head. If you figure 30 houses, they're each doing 200 gallons a household, that's 6,000 gallons.
a day, the plant does 80,000. I don't have my, I left my phone in the car so it wouldn't go off, but if someone can do the math real quickly.
What the percentage?
What the percentage is, and then take that, times it by 10 million, that tells you what their debt service would be over.
Six divided by 80?
Yep.
Times 40,000?
400,000.
30,000.
Divided by 30 homes.
Thousands.
Thousand.
So that tells you the rough percentage-wise what their debt service would be.
So it'd be $1,000 on top of...
their current sewer bill.
Their current sewer bill. Or whatever, whatever. Because realistically, it's not broken, it has never been broken down as to... and again, I know as was asked before, there's no costs between the two plants. So the question is going on that theory, will the amount of money that they get for the usage be able to fund the plant for O&M?
But if you're shutting the plant down and pumping it to South...
No, we're saying just pretend, here you go.
Separate district.
Old Deerfield, here you go. This is your plant, and it's for your 30 people and your three institutions, and that's it. No, nothing. Upgrade the plant. It's completely all on you. You know what I mean?
I know what you're saying.
If we made a district, separate district, we could let them vote whether they wanted to keep the plant or put in a line to the old, to the South Deerfield plant.
But I'm going to play devil's advocate for you. Do they pay for the line? Let's assume you decide you're going to the Butterfly Conservatory. Do they pay for the line up to that, and then everybody else pays for the line because that's technically South Deerfield? Or do they pay for that line plus the gravity line that then all those people in South Deerfield could tie into? I'm just playing devil's advocate.
There's not that many more people in South Deerfield
are going to tie in.
But then when someone from South Deerfield does end up tying in...
They pay an entry fee.
Yeah, $45,000.
So
whatever it is.
So last 6 months, Old Deerfield put in 8 million gallons by the water ratings. The Old Deerfield plant, South Deerfield put in 33 million.
That's during the summer, though, a lot of it.
Well, actually, if you go back to what Barbara had sent out, their winter readings in Old Deerfield are higher than their summer unit readings for the last 2 years.
Right, yeah, that's because the students aren't there.
And that's why I said 8 million. They'd run about around 8 million.
How far back did you get?
So in the winter, it'd be more.
Last couple of years.
Okay.
Bruce? In the winter, it'd be more.
Yeah, right. But it's not a tremendous amount.
Yeah, no, the flow doesn't fluctuate much since you replaced the gravity line and it took a lot of infiltration out.
Yeah. So a lot. So it's running about 25% of what South Deerfield does.
But I don't know how cost-effective it's going to be for them. I mean, you have to run all the numbers out to find out exactly what their O&M would be for that plant.
It's not going to be cost-effective. It's going to be shocking.
Oh, yeah.
That's why maybe they'd like to own it. Maybe the institutions would like to own it and utilize the resources that they have that the town doesn't have.
Well, just playing devil's advocate.
Because they could raise the $10 million, and then they have no debt service.
If you separated the two into separate districts, currently both plants need two operators, but you have three because you share one between the two other plants. So if you did that separation, you may be looking at having to hire another operator.
But you could do what Sunderland does, and they have a private contractor come in and operate their plant.
Or they could contract with the South Deerfield plant to provide an operator on a...
Mm-hmm. Would it be more cost-effective, I'm wondering, to build a new plant that in between both locations and utilize the gravity to the Connecticut River instead of paying for upgrades at both or a $10 million pipe? I'm just wondering, you know.
I don't want to throw that number out because I'm not leaving this room if that happens.
Just curious. Build one new plant.
A whole new plant?
Yeah.
And then you got to get a brand new discharge permit.
No, you don't.
No?
Nope.
No.
You're going into the same basin within, you would not need it, you just combine the permits. You're talking big bucks. 20-plus million to build brand new.
And you got to find a place to put it, too.
You got to buy the land, you got to get there, you're probably talking 2 pump stations.
Got to pump it over Hillside Road to get it down to the river.
I wouldn't recommend that.
20 million?
Just wondered.
20 to 30?
That's a down payment, that's a down payment.
Paying 10 anyway. But paying...
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Well, it's 20 million for 2 plants.
Maybe even build a bigger plant and get revenue sharing from other communities.
Or to run a sewer line.
There's that possibility, too.
It's 20 million.
Put it over here in that commercial property next to Yankee Corporate and have Conway tie into it to help share, cost share it. I mean, that... I know, anytime I bring up sharing...
Jimmy Prochaska will be happy he found a use for his property.
Forget it, it's never going to happen in a million years.
I mean, if you're talking sharing, realistically, if you were talking sharing, the South Deerfield plant with some minor upgrades could take in Conway, Waitley, Old Deerfield, Hatfield, and Sunderland.
Yeah, but if it costs $20 million to go from, or $10 million to go from Old Deerfield to my house, what's it going to cost to go to Conway? With all the rocks and ups and downs and...
That, I'm just saying...
You'd have places where the pipe would have to be 40 feet in the ground, then it'd be 20 feet in the air.
I'm just saying that the capacity-wise...
Yeah, oh, capacity-wise, yeah.
You could handle those flows from at South Deerfield.
I heard Conway was actually thinking about building a new facility.
They're looking at building a treatment plant. It's a long way to pump to get there. We looked at that.
Maybe we could use theirs.
Theirs is like 15,000 gallons a day.
Lots of big tanks.
I have a question on your answers.
Okay.
If I can change subject a little bit, that okay?
That's fine.
Page 5 of 11. Number 3, the Headworks project, the probable cost of $1.5 million, $1,500,000. That was what the Capital Improvement Planning Committee approved for the cost of the Headworks project. 1.4 we approved, right? How do we go from 1.4 or 1.5 to 3 million, yeah.
There was a fairly good sized garage in there, wasn't it?
Yep, there's a memorandum that was attachment, I believe, 3, that went through all the items that were added after that point.
After that number came out.
Is it in here?
Last page.
Yeah, it's a memo to Mr. Finn.
Oh, dated April 19th?
Correct.
The former town manager?
Okay, all right, thank you, I'll read that.
Yep.
Six or seven.
It goes through, there was a garage facility that was added. There was a septic receiving facility that was added.
What is a septic receiving facility?
So when you have a septic tank,
yep.
When it's pumped out,
yep.
That's septic.
Yep.
So that would get brought to the treatment plant. There's a fee charged by the treatment plant and the septic gets treated.
We had that at one time in South Deerfield. Then they stopped using it for whatever reason.
So
I think there was a problem there.
So with the head, that was also when you had Kane's Pickle Factory.
Right.
So with the Headworks facility, the septic would be dumped into a tank with a large bar rack to catch the big rocks and the big rags, and then from there it would flow through the screen, through the grit removal system.
The big rocks.
Septic is notorious for having large rocks in it. I don't know how they get in there. I don't know. Trust me, the stuff that you find in the wastewater treatment plants, you would not believe.
You would not believe what comes through.
In Shelburne Falls, they got a live goldfish in the treatment plant. I swear to God.
No, that's where he ended up.
We get bathing suit parts.
You're talking about this April 16th one. You have an updated one of August 1st. It's even more.
The August 1st one is what was put into Mass Works.
Yeah.
At the time the Mass Works application was going in, the request was to round it up a little bit more.
Do we need a garage? So the garage is $1.5 million?
No.
Roughly?
No.
addition to the, I mean, if you keep rocking through, addition to the new emergency generator, addition for the OPM.
Yeah, well, we could have a generator.
The septic, the garage, let's see what else can we do.
Couldn't a generator sit outside like it does at the highway garage? Doesn't need to be in a building.
No, it is outside, that's what they're good.
Yeah, that's what they're looking at.
Yeah, it's an outside one.
That's inside, because realistically, you put something inside like that, first off, you take it up square footage.
Sure.
And second off, you're talking fumes, the whole line, which is one of the issues that he's running into right now.
Oh, yeah, it's awful.
You are absolutely correct.
Now, if you don't get a Vector truck, do you have to have the big building?
No.
But, add in the butt part.
All right, we'll turn the page.
What's the Vector truck do?
So,
That would actually be a really good thing to have.
A lot of things. It flushes sewers, it pumps out manholes, pumps out catch basins, pumps out scum wells, allows you to empty tanks out and suck out all the sludge and crap at the bottom of the tanks.
What tanks?
Lift stations.
Oh, any tank.
Any tank.
Okay.
That was actually...
What are we doing now?
We rent one for Montague, right?
We've only used one.
Eight of 11.
Everybody keeps throwing Montague out.
Okay.
We've only been out once. Every other time, we've been dealing with Mohawk.
How much a year are we spending?
We're spending about 35, 40 grand a year.
Page eight of 11.
So there's, seems to me it's a pretty bad payback on building, on buying a truck and building a building for it.
There's a potential increase which is in here?
So page eight of 11, one of the questions that was asked, because it was shown on the CIP, and the CIP was kind of put together to help with the rate study, and, you know, sometimes you ask for the world, but you don't get it, and that's, the Vector truck was one of Kevin's.
We can get it for free, we'll take it.
But,
so why is it needed? Proper maintenance and cleaning of the sanitary sewer mains. It's also used for flushing the drainage system. So you'd use it for DPW and wastewater.
Oh, so you're going to do other public works, not just the people on the sewer?
Correct.
So then that cost should be shared by everybody in the town?
Sure. Right.
Correct.
Yep.
So your current budget is $33,000 a year for sewer and drain flushing. And this is out of his mouth, not mine. It's currently not adequately funded to do what you do need to do. You'd basically be looking at double that. You're looking at roughly $65,000 for him to be able to do it on a more frequent basis.
And it's still not being 100%.
So we're paying, how much are we paying to get it ourselves? We have to get a garage, we have to get the truck. What's the total cost to have that truck?
$500,000, maybe?
$400,000.
The truck is $400,000, and then you have to have a place to store it, is his point is.
Right.
And what's the operational cost?
Can we stay with the capital 1 second?
The garage portion, you're looking at roughly $330,000, but you can't just eliminate, it's not an apples-to-apples comparison, because if you eliminate the garage, I have my electrical panels in the garage side, because I can't put them in the headwork side, because it's an explosive environment. So that $300,000 comes down $200,000, $250,000, somewhere in that range. So that's the cost, apples to apples comparison.
So $600,000.
$600,000 is a good number.
So roughly, it's going to take, if we keep renting it, it's a 10-year payback.
Yes.
Roughly.
Without
operation costs.
Without operational costs.
Now,
that piece of machinery that's got a 20-25 year replacement.
So the other thing to keep in mind, and I know you're not in the MS4 requirements, Greenfield, I believe, is.
Greenfield is in Northampton.
And Northampton is.
And what is that?
MS4 requires additional maintenance and cleaning requirements of the drainage system. And Kevin actually looked into, luckily for the last round, you guys were not one of the communities that got added into it.
Yep.
Yep.
Just would be a matter of time before we are.
You could be looking at an annual operating cost somewhere in the $100,000 to $200,000 range, with, because you'll basically have a crew that their job is nonstop flushing drain lines, cleaning out catch basins.
Mm-hmm. We're still gonna have space, we pay them ourselves, or we pay somebody else to do it.
But what, I guess where Kevin was going on the Vector truck, when you're looking at the paybacks, if it's $600,000 and you're paying $200,000 a year, now it's a 3-year payback. And again, you don't have an MS4 permit, so we're talking hypothetical.
We could get earnings, because Kevin's not going to be using that 365 days a year.
Exactly. I mean, you know, we could do the same thing that Montague's doing right now.
Rent it?
But keep in the back of your mind, when you do that, you have to take two people out of a six-man crew. So now you just take it to a four-man crew to be able to go to someplace else to try and make money.
The one thing I will give Kevin a lot of credit on is the mechanic he's got down at DPW. That guy's amazing, keeping that equipment running. So the maintenance of the truck, I would not be worried at one bit.
Well, how many days would you actually need that truck for the purpose of the town of Deerfield?
Present time right now?
Hold on. With proper maintenance program, it should be used at least once per week for the sewer system and once per week for the DPW system. So you'd use it 2 days a week.
2 days, but one day would be charged to the ratepayers, and the other day to the town.
Correct.
So we'd have three when you didn't have a holiday in a week that you could rent it out.
Correct.
Here again, is it worthwhile renting?
Well, if you couldn't.
Typically, rentals don't work. My experience is, the town of Hatfield needed somebody to help plow the roads with them. We sent somebody over there, we helped them plow. The agreement was that later in the future, they would pay us back. No money exchange hands, rentals don't work with towns.
Well, I think when he says rentals, it's rental of equipment and personnel. So in other words, very similar to like what we're doing with Montague right now. If we go ahead and bring in Montague, it's $125 an hour plus, two-hour minimum, that's invoiced to us. And we get the invoice and we have to pay it. So inadvertently, if that was the theory, we would be doing the same thing. We would go to Montague if their truck broke down. I mean, because Montague right now, they run their truck at least 4 days a week, 5 days a week.
So they charge $125 an hour? Does that include two men?
I can't tell you off the top of my head. No, I'm not going to throw out a number because I'll be wrong, and I'll be held to that number, so.
Well, you're saying it takes two men to operate the truck, so that's why, that's why I was wondering if they're furnishing two men for $125 an hour, in which case, that's one hell of a bargain.
Plus the truck, right.
Plus the truck, keep renting from Montague. If that's a realistic number.
I'd have to look.
You know, that's. Because otherwise you're saying you're going to cut your crew down, and the next thing you're going to do is looking for somebody else to fill out your crew. Now you've got that. So now by the time you get done with benefits and so forth, you're going to add on another $50,000, $60,000.
What's the difference between 304 SS and 316 SS?
Well, stainless steel.
Yeah, it's the strength of the stainless steel. The 316th is substantially better.
304 is the magnetic cheap stuff. The 316 is the non-magnetic.
Yeah, you can run chlorine through 316.
If we're going to pay for it, we may as well get the better.
Well, yeah, the other stuff will get you.
You said that's explosion-proof equipment you have to have?
Correct.
I didn't realize they needed explosion-proof for sewers.
Yeah.
That's the way it is at Old Deerfield right now. Explosion-proof.
NFPA 20, which is the guidelines for fire hazard.
H2S.
That building, it's not H2S, it's the issue with there could possibly be methane generated, but also someone might inadvertently dump gasoline, it makes its way into the sewer system, and now you have a flash hazard. Mm-hmm. So you'd have that is under the NFPA code, the Headworks building is a class 1 Div 2 environment requiring explosion proof components.
Class 1 Division 2?
Really expensive.
So it sounds like anything that we're talking about here, we're talking if a decision was made right now, 2 years before anything got done, from the sounds of this, because everyone these answers is a year for engineering and a year for construction.
No, they're almost done with the engineering on the Headworks building.
Headworks is sitting right there.
Only the Headworks. We're talking about anything else.
Headworks is bid ready. We still got to go through permitting with Mass DEP, but we've kept them in the loop, and they're actually excited. You guys are looking to do some capital.
But anything else, such as working on Old Deerfield plan or anything like that, we're talking if decisions were made right now.
Realistically.
2 years away.
If you made a decision right now, I would say you're 3 to 5 years before you put a shovel in the ground, because you got to get your financing plan put together, you got to get, you know, there's input, town meetings and...
And we have equipment that may or may not last that long.
How about the Mass Works grant? You say that we're not eligible now?
You didn't get it.
We didn't get it.
We didn't get it, so now we got to put in for next year?
Correct.
That's my
recommendation. Is there any probability we'll get it next year, or is this...
Well, when you did River Road, you didn't get it the first year, but you got it the second year.
Correct.
I have to admit, Doug did an awesome job. You have so many letters of support. I was surprised you didn't get funded, to be honest.
You still 12 years to get the parking garage.
It's a big, that was a big nut, though, $7.5 million. Brockton got 10. I'm surprised they got that, but population center.
Well, the Headworks is ready to go to bid.
Headworks is ready to go.
Hasn't been approved by Capital Improvement Planning Committee for that amount of money.
No, you, we're just, we collectively asked to put together a set of bid ready document, and that is what is sitting on the table. Whether it's been approved to do it, that's a completely different story. All you asked for was a set of plans.
CIPC approved.
CIPC approved.
Approved the expending the funds to
the engineering.
The engineering.
Oh, that's true. You're right.
Which is what's sitting on the table.
Yep, wrong.
So we still have to.
So the next step is to put it to bid and then go to town meeting and get the appropriation to pay for it.
If that's the way you guys
want
to
go. Or we hold back a little bit and see if next year we get the Mass Works grant.
I think we need to put a pencil to the back of the truck.
Which is fine. I mean, I by no means am I here to argue for the truck.
You want a sharp pencil or?
I'm just giving you what your different options are. You know, I'm not trying to champion anything one way or the other. I'm just trying to make sure that the information that is being put in front of you, the decisions that you make, are an educated decision on the information that is given.
And we do appreciate that, believe me.
But the Vector truck is, half is going to be charged to the town as a whole, and the other half to the ratepayers.
It could, if that's how you
decide. Well,
if that's how you decide to do it.
That's the purpose.
And it could be flat up, completely belongs to wastewater treatment, and wastewater treatment goes ahead and charges the town for usage.
I'd rather have it the other way, Kevin.
You know, I don't care who pays, but I think we ought to be doing what's best for the people in the town, whether it's sewer ratepayers or taxpayers.
Overall, yes, but it's still, if we have this wall of, you know, this is, I'm going to pay for this, but I'm not going to pay for that, that has to be part and parcel of the conversation. Mm-hmm. Now, it's like the sewer camera, okay, that came out of sewer funds. That's being used by the town, okay? So, but yet, it was specifically voted out of sewer funds.
The ratepayers paid for it.
That came out of sewer.
Yeah. I'm saying the ratepayers.
But the town paid.
Just so you're aware, the only time that camera has not been used for sewer was today at the bridge.
So, well, it sounded like they were using it for drains too.
No.
So.
We have not used it for drains. At least not to my knowledge.
Well, that's what comments that were made.
Anyway.
Well, we
just got to properly.
So now we got a question of, do we spend $1.5 million on the Headworks, or do we go for $3.5 million? There's a big difference there. Well, I think we got to figure that out. The question is, if we go for the 3.5, do we turn around and go and try and get the 20% grant from USDA, and then go for the low interest loan? Or are we better off waiting for a year to see what's going to transpire in the next year?
Here would be my recommendation, and I'm just speaking out loud.
That's what we want you for. And you're appreciated, believe me.
Thank you.
True.
I would wait and put in another Mass Works round, because getting the space for the garage sets you up in the future if you decide to do a Vector truck. You may get an MS4 permit 5 years down the road and look at, geez, we're spending $200,000 a year. We could have this truck ourselves. It paid for itself in 3 years. But now you don't have any place to store it, because these trucks they're like fire trucks. They're huge. So that's the first thing. The second thing is waiting to go to Mass Works again buys you a year to do your planning, figure out what you want to do. Because if you don't get the Mass Works grant and you decide, you know what, we're going to upgrade South Deerfield's plant, Well, building this clarifier and building this building and doing the electrical, you get economies of scale. So instead of doing a $3.4 million project, you do a $7.5, $8 million, $9 million project. Well, now all of a sudden it's a bigger project. You've gotten economies of scale because you combine two projects. Plus, now you may be eligible to get more grants from USDA.
Okay, so the game plan that you're recommending is hold off for a year, apply for another Mass Works, which means they won't do anything until at least a year from now. Meanwhile, how much do we owe you for engineering that we have to pay for by December 31st?
You are 100% paid up.
We are 100% paid up.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
But should we go along with the actual screening part of the headworks?
No, because if you don't really have a place to put it, you'd be...
It's got to be inside.
Yeah, it's got to be inside a building. The channel's not big enough.
But I know I asked this before, but even a lot of those modernizations, more than likely the aeration tanks are going to stay the same.
Yeah.
Wouldn't it make sense to try to protect them? And, you know, I don't know, can you drain one and can we line that and then switch over, then line the other one?
So what I've done in the past at other facilities, same vintage as yours, you go in, you drain one tank, you put a structural engineer in it, he goes around, he taps the tank, listens for hollow spots, marks them with spray paint, we come up with a rough quantity, and then you do chemical injection grouts into those. You fix wherever parts of the tanks are sprawling.
Well, I haven't seen all of them, but when I see the tank, it's more or less right around the
freeze line,
the feed line, you
yep.
know, where it's getting eaten away. And that's what I'd like to see get protected sooner than later. You know, it's not going to cost any more to do it now than it is later. And I understand the whole part about, you know, there's water in one tank just to offset the pressure. But if there's some way it can be lowered enough so you can, you know, coat one tank and then switch over, then go add and coat the other tank, at least then we're protecting it from getting eroded more. Some of those stones are getting so eroded that it's going to start crumbling.
The way the tanks are set up, and I don't know if you've tried this before, Keith, but you should be able to have one tank completely full with one tank completely empty.
He explained to me before, and I agreed with his philosophy about keeping, was it 6 feet of water in one? Or
yeah, approximately.
Just
sometimes
to keep
a little more than that.
You know, balance.
Just to keep it equalized.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's perfectly fine to do that.
And I think part of the reason was because of the cracks in there.
Yeah, and that and the water table sometimes comes up really high.
Right.
So that was a concern, too, and that was passed on to me by Don Chappelle, that it would be a good idea to keep the tank about half full.
Yeah, you do have, I believe there are surge valves, so if the water table comes up, the tank's going to fill up anyways.
Mm.
But you can empty it and put the coatings and stuff on it. Yeah.
In fact, before the one that has water in it now, that was taken out of service. We swapped to the other one, and we let it dry out, and then we had a company come in and remove all the grit, and it was quite something to see that. It was a mountain of grit. By the time it was dry enough to remove, it looked like the Amazon jungle growing out of it. Every kind of flora, fauna, and tomato plant out there was grown out of that.
What do you mean it was dry enough to clear out? You couldn't
get it? Well, they needed it to dry out for a certain amount of time. I'm not sure why. Oh. Maybe it's a regulatory thing or...
Well, it's just, it's a lot of water. It's
a lot of water weight.
You're picking it 17, 18, 20 feet in the air.
But it took a couple of bobcats being lowered into that tank with cranes, pushing all that stuff around and putting it into a bucket, and then having the bucket come up, go into the back of a dump truck, that made repeated trips out of there to get it totally cleaned out. Because it had been in service since the beginning of the plant construction. Mm-hmm. And when it was finally switched out, there was literally about 20% of the capacity was to be taken up with grit.
Grit, yeah.
We don't have any grit removal, which would be part of the headworks project. So, and I'm sure old Deerfield's in the same situation right now, and I've been really wanting to take that tank out of service. It's been in service since day one. Mm. It's never been switched. Never. And not once.
Tony, have you worked with any contractors that spray this epoxy?
I have. I have a contractor that I'm doing a project in Connecticut with that they are lining the inside of a wet well.
Okay.
So the one thing you may run into is under Mass General laws, this type of application would have to be done under your Chapter 149. The bid threshold is $25,000.
What's that mean?
Means you have to go out under a filed sub bid for anything over $25,000, you have to physically put it on the street and have these specific contractors bid on it.
You think it?
Thanks to the state.
Unions. I can give Kevin my contact with PPG. I'm at Pittsburgh Paints. I'm actually meeting with her on Thursday. You can have her come up and take a look at it and give you an idea.
I've had a guy come around twice now looking to sell me coatings for concrete, for walls. And I think he said it was a bargain at $180 a gallon. And you could apply it even in wet conditions, it could be applied. What it is, how good it is, I don't know. I've been a little skeptical.
I trust the lady I deal with at PPG.
The fly-by-night people that kind of pop around.
Yeah, they do. They come all the time to the plant trying to sell me stuff. And I usually take it with a grain of salt. Every once in a while, there's a value in it. Mm. But you have to be really careful with that. They do just show up and try to sell you things. And they bring samples, and they keep bothering you. And if I had a fax machine live, which I don't anymore, thank goodness, I'd be getting spam faxes all day long from...
snake oil.
Yeah, exactly. So,
what's wrong with snake oil?
You got to be a good salesman to sell it, right?
That's right. Everybody's got to make a buck. So right now, the consensus basically is that we're going to wait for another year. We're going to reapply for Mass Works. The engineering costs that were already paid for, I presume, out of the sewer reserve or whatever we had.
Correct.
So that's all set.
And
we still got to keep plugging away to figure out what a priority. What would it cost for engineering to go to eliminate the system over on
Captain
Lathrop and go gravity? What would the engineering cost for that?
So I had given, Kevin had actually asked me for this. I gave him a proposal of roughly under $4,000 just to go out there and physically survey it to make sure it could work. And then figure out, give you guys an actual cost of, okay, this is how deep the sewer needs to be, this is how much we think it's going to cost.
Well, personally, I think the $4,000 is pretty cheap to do that.
It is, but I did speak with John Jankowski and a bunch of other people, and they said that at the time, Eddie Crafts wanted to do that in the worst way, but the elevation change wasn't enough. And they were even talking about how they could, you know, use it or keep it flat for quite a ways, and rely on angles of the pipes coming in from the houses, because the houses were higher to keep it moving.
Yeah.
And they decided that they just couldn't do it. So.
Okay, so you're adding more information into it.
Yeah. Especially with rag material. If you had that marginal with rag material in the flow, that would be a disaster waiting to happen. You need some good substantive flow there. You need a good...
Next time you have an issue over it, would you call me just so I can stick my head in there? And
we're there twice a week. We're there Mondays and Fridays. And anytime that you want, I have a key in my pocket. I'd be more than happy to walk
around. 8 o'clock tomorrow morning, he'll meet you there.
Okay. Give him the Tyvek suit?
No.
Yeah, you're welcome to come to South Deerfield and help us derag an aerator once or twice, too. See how that
your
works.
Your own Tyvek suit.
I have my own key.
I have my
own Tyvek suit.
So is there any idea why the discrepancy between your story and his story as far as the inverts on why it's not feasible?
Oh, I don't think there is a discrepancy. I'm just saying what, you know, I talked with John and can't think of the other guy about it. And, you know, he said he just wanted to go out and shoot elevations to see, you know, what it is. But I think that, you know, you could do that pretty easily just by opening up, I don't know, those manhole covers.
You volunteered.
Yeah.
4 meetings ago, you volunteered to come do that.
Yeah.
Yeah, but
to come shoot all the elevations to find out whether that was feasible or not. Because when I came to ask to spend the $43.45, I can't remember exactly what
the number was. I think it was $39.95 or whatever it was.
Yeah.
Less than $4,000.
What it was.
It was less than $4,000.
You said that you were going to go out and shoot the elevations for me.
I could do that. Okay. I still can do it.
But the $4,000 is not just for shooting elevations. That's to work up a cost to do the project.
Yeah, but the elevations are the key part of the equation.
I know, but the thing is, for $4,000, it's a cheap investment that I think we should spend.
I agree with you.
Authorize, go see if it can be done. That way we hire a professional engineer to do it.
That's right.
They go in there and say, yes, it can be done, and this is what you have to do, and this is where you have to go, and then we can turn it over to the town and say, okay, get these right-of-ways.
As well as the fact that if there are other questions that come up while they are shooting grades and so forth, they'll be right there, and they'll be able to answer their own questions.
It would, but wouldn't it go down the side of the road?
I was figuring we're going to put the sewer exactly where the sewer is.
Yeah.
So you shoot the grade, you pop the manholes, we'll shoot the edge of the road, shoot the houses. Basically, we start building the base map so that...
You wouldn't need to take any land for that.
I thought at one time they said that you were going to go on the other side onto all the people's...
Yeah.
Billy Mono's house is that there was supposedly an easement reserve on the east side of the brook.
Right, that's why I said I thought there was something that you had to continue that route that it was going.
I don't know.
All I know is I'd rather for $4,000, that's cheap enough.
Yeah.
We spend more than that on electric bill every month. To me, I'd rather see that going. I'd rather make a motion and say, we send a recommendation to the Board of Selectmen to sign the contract and let's get going on that. I think that's critical. If we can do that, we're doing something to fix something in town. We're better off to do something than nothing.
You have enough money appropriated, or is that going to have to take a transfer from the Finance Committee?
I could probably find some money somewhere within my budget.
He's okay. Saving it because that was the interest that he was saving for the Vector truck.
Right.
Anyway, I just put him on the spot. He's got enough money.
I know, he knows.
So.
All right.
Is that a motion, John?
Yes, I'll make a motion that we recommend to the Board of Selectmen to sign the $3,995 contract.
Not to exceed
$4,000 to have the engineers do it and come back with a recommendation on how we can do this. Is there
the
a second?
I'll second.
Further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye, aye, aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed?
What?
Is that your job?
That's your job. I'm just helping him.
Yeah, but your problem is he gets $5,000 a year, Jack. You get nothing.
Yeah, but when I started, I used to make $1,200 a year. What more do you want?
That's all you guys are worth.
That's all we're worth 20 years ago, yeah.
Did you tell them that we applied for a grant or no?
Which one?
For the planning grant?
No, I didn't.
No, you didn't?
No.
So... you were talking about things to do in this year before you reapply. One of the things that is to get the planning done of what do you want to do town-wide? You're going to shut down Old Deerfield. What is it going to cost you to upgrade South Deerfield? Where and if are you going to expand sewers? What are the costs? What is the you need the robust financial plan. What is it going to cost people? Because that's the big question that everybody wants to know. Is it going to cost me $200 a year? Is it going to cost me $1,000 a year? So... End of October, beginning of October, sometime in October, MassDEP put out a request for grant applications for a total of $40,000. So the town, Kevin, applied for a $40,000 planning grant to go towards this townwide planning study. Under the previous administration, Doug had asked us to prepare a proposal to do this planning study. So we had prepared that, and that was the scope that the town used to apply for this grant. So if you get it, you'll have $40,000 to apply towards the planning.
Towards the planning stage.
But in the planning phase, can it also encompass the alternatives of setting up separate sewer districts and how you do this thing and what have you?
That's more of a
political, I know.
Yeah, it's more political than it is engineering.
Political and legal.
Well, I mean, we have town council and what have you, and, yeah, you know, it's going to take some thinking out of the box to try to figure out the alternatives. And
he's out of the box.
I doubt the town attorney is going to have the expertise to make a decision.
The only thing the town attorney is going to do is say, you give me a proposal and I'll tell you if it's illegal or not.
I don't know, but I'd be surprised.
Well, anyway.
Seems to be like a pretty specialized area.
That's why we got him here. He's your specialist. That I really appreciate you coming, believe me.
Yes.
I can't emphasize that.
We all do.
Seriously.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
It was enlightening.
So what do we do next, Bo?
Hey, if you guys want me to give you the dissertation on biological treatment, I'm here for another hour.
Well, we want you to get home and take care of those little kids.
They'll be asleep.
They'll be sleeping.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you can wake them up.
You hope.
No, they'll be sleeping. Hopefully my wife's sleeping, too.
Not when I call.
She's probably asleep, too.
He always, going, walking into a meeting, he'll always, hey, I got a question on this. I'm like, I'm feeding the kids right now. What is it? Can it be quick?
No.
So.
Yeah, he's billed me out many times. Many, many times.
When are we going to have our next meeting?
I think we already have a date set for December 1st, Thursday night.
There's a zoning hearing that night here. That's a Thursday night.
Zoning Board of Appeals.
And I'm going to be at that. If they need me. If they don't need me, I'm going to be there.
I have a question.
6 o'clock, December 1st?
Yeah, that's what we had set.
The zoning hearings are set for 7, I believe.
September 1st?
December.
Yeah, December 1st?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's 2 weeks.
It's a Thursday, isn't it?
Yeah. It's the first Thursday of the month.
Do you want to kick it into the next week?
Doesn't matter.
I'm going to be in Florida until the 10th.
Oh, that's right, too.
If you want to make it the week after, I'll be here. If you don't, have it a week early, and I won't be here.
Well, we can meet on the 1st, but at 7 o'clock, the zoning hearing is scheduled.
I know, that's what you said.
And so.
So could we have our meeting earlier?
I'm going to start at 6 and be done with 7.
I doubt it.
You could do 5:30.
What do we want to talk about? What do we as a committee want to pursue next? Maybe that's what we want to talk about.
Well, when are you going to have the information if the selectmen tomorrow night approve doing that little job? When do you think you'll have some information on that? We won't have it for the 1st of December, will we?
Do you want to kick it into the week of the 12th through the 16th?
Thursday night's fine.
December.
Then. You do it the 15th of December?
What night is that?
Thursday
would be fine with me.
Well, how's that work for everybody else?
Good for you.
You'll be back, right?
I'll be back. That's good.
Bruce, you'll be around?
As far as I know.
Okay, so it's the 15th of December.
At 6.
At 6?
I will talk to the survey crew and see when they're planning to get out here. Realistically, a month should be more than enough time.
Keith, that good for you?
Yes.
Kevin, how about you? That's good for you? That good for you? The 15th of December, 6 o'clock, for sewer rate, our next meeting?
That's the third Thursday. That's my Prudential Committee meeting.
Should we get a legal opinion about having two districts, see if we can do it, and then knowing that, then we can decide whether we want to meet with the three schools?
I'll tell you the guy that could probably give you the answer. He's not an attorney.
Can we just do that?
And I don't know how well he is of late. Tommy Scanlon, the father, can probably tell you how you can do it, whether you can or you can't do it.
I'm sure he will.
But how's he doing?
He's back to work, I understand.
Oh, yeah, it's part-time.
But what I'm just trying to say, I don't want to put too much on his plate, but I think that he's a guy that could probably tell you what the answer is, and then he'd probably tell you to go check with the lawyers, but he's probably got more knowledge of districts and what have you than anybody in this part of the state.
Then that to go through legislature.
How about if you go and ask him and report back on December 15th?
I think it does.
I could try.
Which is 3 to 5 years.
That sounds good, yeah.
You really want to do that, though.
He goes over to John's I might even see him down there. He goes to John's pretty frequently.
Does he want to ask him the questions then?
You ask.
Or you want to have Bobby do it?
No, let Kippy do it, because if Kippy's going to see him every day.
Yeah, you're the chairman, you're the boss.
So do you get the big bucks for?
Yeah, I know.
That's right. No, this one's free.
This one's free.
This one's free, but I mean,
he gets the $5,000 for everything else.
But next year he gets a chairmanship and he gets another grant.
You burned that all. That money got all burned up on the roof. But it paid off. That $5,000 investment saved about $800,000.
You've been cost effective.
Yeah, it's going to get better.
If you weren't, we'd tell you.
It's going to get better. You wait and see.
So you can see Charlie.
Never penny wise and dollar foolish.
Never.
Because that's why we're in the position we're in right now. That's the only statement I'm going to make.
So how was, how's
I agree with you, Kevin.
You've made many statements today.
Well, that's the only one I'm going to make for the rest of the night, because my mind's on overload right now, so.
So are we doing manhole inspections at this point?
No.
So sewer line inspections, anything?
No.
Or is there no funding for any of that right
now? There's no funding for any of that right now.
One thing to keep in mind is December 31st of 2017, you have to submit a, by Mass state law, you have to submit an SSES report.
Which is inspection of all of my lines, inspection of all of my manholes.
And other things on top of that. Smoke testing.
Is that going to be in your budgets for this year?
That's what I'm hoping.
Well, are you going to put it in your budget?
Oh, I'm going to put it in. Oh, yeah, well, no. I'm
subject to the finance committee.
With that commentary.
Right.
Yeah, who's going to pay for that, the town or the ratepayers?
It's got to be the ratepayers, because it's all part of the rate. Sorry, I mean, if everybody's cutting that line where this is the ratepayers and this is the town, and we're not going to spend, the town's not going to spend any money to do anything with the sewer, then unfortunately, and I just want to make this real public, I'm a sewer user also, so any of these rates and everything else that's coming up is affecting me personally besides.
But this report just going to include sewers, it's not going to do the drainage systems or anything else.
It'll just be sewers.
Sewer only.
I tried.
No, I would make the recommendation, you guys, the town did a lot of work in the early 2000s. I would make the recommendation, I can do it on your behalf if you give me the authorization. You reach out to Mass DEP and say, hey, we did this 10 years ago. Is that good enough, or what do you need us to update?
We found a major problem there with one manhole that was screwed up, and it cost us $60,000 or $80,000 to replace that, because the stream was running right through it. We had to re-divert that water, the sewer, around two manholes and then rebuild that.
We're being penny wise and dollar foolish by not doing it, by taking advantage of what you're suggesting. Maybe we should do it.
You've done a lot of work in, at least in South Deerfield, and ever since you replaced that pipe in Old Deerfield, which I want to say that was $500,000.
Dramatic difference.
Huge difference. You went from 200,000 gallons a day on average over a 12-month period to 80.
Mm-hmm.
And in the summertime, you were down to like nothing.
I saw the flow as low as 7,000 gallons one day when I was working over there.
Should have done
the summer.
Upgrade when they were used.
I mean, it was just unbelievable.
Okay.
Unbelievable.
You want to motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
So it is December 15th at 6.
Yes.
So we're going to adjourn for proper refreshments, right?
Anybody second it?
Second.
All those in favor?
All right. All right.